All right. Hello there, everyone. How's it going?
Hi.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Okay. So we got a few things to go over today. I'll kind of give you guys an overview, and we'll look at a little bit on Project One, since that's going to be due not next week, but the following week. I'll just show you a couple student examples there. And then we'll have a short lecture on focal point and leading lines and how to create that in your compositions. And then I will kind of just give you a general intro to Adobe Illustrator. I'll kind of just demo a few things. And then I'm going to send you guys back to your own computers with the links to the videos that I've created and have you guys kind of try all that on your own. Do that on your own time and do that later today and over the next few days, and kind of just see what work on getting those basics done for Adobe Illustrator. So just to start, did everyone receive that email from Adobe directing you to a free download of the program?
Yeah,
I did.
Good. Did anyone get that installed okay on your computer?
Yes.
Yep.
Awesome. Good. So glad you guys got that all good. If for some reason anyone has any issues with that, just let me know and I can direct you guys to IT if anything comes up, but it sounds like it's working for most of you. So that's good. That's a good first step of getting Illustrator. And so later today, I'll just kind of go over the basics, just of like the main tools that we'll use, kind of how to use that, and the general expectations of kind of what you need to start learning this week, so you kind of just stay on track. Like I said, Illustrator is a really complicated program. It's just going to take you guys some time of kind of going and basically just doing the same basic thing over and over and over again until you get really comfortable with it. So I think I mentioned last class that the first project is not very creative. It's really kind of like a basic checklist to make sure you understand the basics of Illustrator. So I really want you guys to take this first 2 weeks to get the basics of Illustrator down. Because then after that, we're going to start making art with Illustrator. So it's going to get a lot more complicated because we're going to be applying the art concepts we're talking about and making cool, interesting art and compositions. But you need to have a handle for the basics of the program in order to do that. So did anyone like open up and poke around on Illustrator at all when they got it downloaded?
I did. It's been interesting. Some things are cool. I've been watching a couple videos.
Oh, good.
They have learning videos of
nice.
When you download it. They have some tool things, but it's been interesting, that's for sure.
Sounds like a little tricky at times. So there will be a bit of a learning curve, like I said. So the more time you can spend with the program, the easier it'll be. And yeah, it really just takes a little bit of time. So we'll kind of go over that here in a little bit. So just also to start, where did that go? All right, so I mentioned drawing challenges last class. Did I mention that? Hopefully, briefly.
You did. Yep.
Okay, cool. So I created our first drawing challenge right here. So it's always under this discussion section. We're gonna do these on Canvas the first 2 weeks. And then when we're back in person, if we get back in person, fingers crossed, we may do these in class. Or I may just kind of keep doing them on Canvas as well. Again, they're just ways to make sure you guys can practice and understand the art concepts we go over. So last class, we were talking about line variety and line weight. Make sure you're using a variety of line in your drawings. Make sure you're using thick and thin lines in your drawings. So here's the drawing challenge. It's called line weight drawing. I'll send everyone a reminder message after class. And in case anyone isn't here, just so they see that. But basically what you're going to do. I got all the instructions here, but you're just going to do a drawing in your sketchbook about 4 by 6 inches, a little bigger, a little smaller is okay. So this drawing is all done with one line weight. So it's all the lines have equal importance, and there isn't that much visually interesting because all the line weights are the same. So what I want you to do is redraw this image, but with a variety of line weights and a variety of line qualities, okay? So think about, where would it be better to have thick lines? Where would it be better to have thin lines? Do you want to use texture lines anywhere? Do you want to use like really messy and jerky lines somewhere? Do you want to use really straight and clean lines in places? And this is just kind of an opportunity for you to experiment with whatever drawing tool you have. So if you're using a ballpoint pen or a pencil, or a brush pen or a Sharpie, or you might combine some of those mediums to recreate this drawing, but do it with a lot of line variety, okay? And that will be due Monday, so before the next class, basically. So just kind of work on it over the weekend. Any questions on this? So when you do it in your sketchbook, you'll just take a picture of it with your phone. I find that's the easiest way. And then you can upload that image to this discussion. You'll just reply down here, and that gives you an opportunity to upload a photo with it. It's worth 5 points, not a lot of points, but as we do these throughout the quarter, it will add up and will affect your grade. Any questions on that?
No.
Cool. Yeah, I'll send a reminder to later today or tomorrow as well. Okay. All right, let's talk about focal point and leading lines, and then we'll get into Illustrator. So this is kind of our vocabulary for today. Focal point, leading lines, and then this is kind of the Illustrator vocabulary that we'll talk about later today. All right, so focal points, very, very important. Almost every single image that we create for the entire rest of the quarter is going to have a focal point in it. Now, what is a focal point? Has anyone heard of a focal point before in terms of an image, or know what a focal point might be?
I guess generally a focal point is the first place your eye will go to when you look at something.
Yes, exactly. It's the main subject matter, and ideally, if you've done a good job composing your image, it's the first thing that people are going to look at. So it's going to stand out in whatever you want to stand out in the image and the composition, and then whatever people will look at first, and also what people will look at the longest. So you're designing this composition, you have a focal point there, people notice that first, that stands out first, they look at it the most, and then their eye will wander around the rest of the image. So we'll look at some examples. This is very key for any sorts of drawing, but it's used a lot in film and animation and photography as well. So the biggest thing when you are creating an image is to know your focal point. If you don't know your focal point, then whoever's looking at your image isn't going to know your focal point. So usually before I sit down to start a drawing or to start any sort of a sketch, I have in my mind, I want this to be the focal point, okay? And that goes for abstract compositions or representational compositions as well. So knowing that focal point before you even start drawing is going to be important. And oftentimes I'll like start a drawing, a sketch, a composition. Let's just do an abstract version here. And let's say I will kind of sometimes draw my focal point over here. So let's just create an abstract shape. I will lots of times just draw this first before I even start the composition. Then I'll be like, oh, okay, where do I want to put that focal point? I want to put it here. Okay. And so the main point when we're creating a composition with a focal point is we want it to be super clear to the viewer. There will be some times where you want to hide a focal point or you don't want a focal point, but we'll get into that later in the quarter. But for the most part, you want that focal point to be super clear to the viewer. You never want them to be confused about what is the focal point or what is the main focus of that composition. And a good way to make that focal point stand out is through the use of leading lines. And leading lines are basically lines that act as arrows. So for abstract compositions, it's very easy to add some leading lines in here. I'm just going to make a few lines that point and reinforce this focal point. So make sure you guys are sketching along with me here in your sketchbooks or whatever you have to take notes in. So I'm just kind of beating you guys over the head with this, whoever's looking at this, to all these little lines act as arrows. So these are basically arrows that direct the viewer's vision of where to look. And this is a very simple composition right now. There's really only one shape in there. But I'm just trying to make it like overly clear to the viewer. So let's do another abstract example. Turn that on. So remember, we always start with the frame for our drawings. So let's create a shape like that for our focal point, abstract. But if I have multiple shapes, which one's the focal point? This is where leading lines could come in handy. So as you see now, all of these start to act as leading lines in there. It kind of brings our vision past these extra shapes around here and then makes us focus on that one shape. And what I could do also is change the line weight. So we talked about that line weight last week or last class. All I can do is put a thicker line around there as well. So now I have a really clear focal point. There's a lot of shapes in this composition, but through the use of leading lines and through the use of thicker line weight, I've made that one focal point really clear. So like I said, we'll do abstract examples and representational ones here, but these abstract ones are nice to just kind of illustrate the overall idea. It gets a little trickier when we start to work representationally, but we'll do a few examples here in a minute. But just to start, you know, this is a good way to show that. And basically, I mean, you could turn these into little arrows. And whether you have them as arrows or not, you're going to have that, the viewer's eye is going to follow those lines. It's just kind of something naturally that happens to human vision. Our vision follows along those sorts of lines. So let's keep that same shape as a focal point. So I know my focal point. This is my focal point. So that's going to be a question that I ask you guys lots of times when I look at your drawing or I look at a sketch that you're thinking of turning in. I would say, do you know the focal point? And that's something you should always ask yourself when you're working on a drawing. What is my focal point? Is my focal point clear to the viewer? So we'll put in that focal point. I'm just going to build a few other abstract shapes around here. So they don't always have to be literal lines. So what you can do also is you can use shapes to act as arrows. They can be shapes, or they can be literal lines, or they can be shapes, or they can basically be arrows. So I can create shapes that go in a line too. So these shapes now will kind of create a dotted line. And I can create shapes that act as arrows as well. So kind of triangular shapes that point at the focal point. And then I could add some lines as well. So they can be very thin lines as well. They don't have to always be bold and standing out. They can be subtle. So I'm just lightening this line. I kind of want some subtler lines in here. Now what I will do is I'll take this nice bright green and kind of then draw on top of this. So what this is doing now is creating pathways for our vision that goes to that focal point. So everything is kind of drawing in towards that focal point, bringing our vision in. And it's good to practice it here with these abstract versions first, and then we'll kind of see how to do it representationally. So that's the main goal, just kind of move that vision out. And for the most part, we'll just deal with one focal point. Especially for the first couple projects, just worry about creating one focal point. Eventually, as we get on to the final project, maybe you'll have a composition that has two focal points. Some compositions can have two or three, but if you get more than three focal points, then it starts to get busy and it's hard to just focus on that one thing. So for you guys, for the most part, just stick with one focal point as we work, and then maybe you'll get to creating ones with more than one focal point. Okay, let's do representational leading lines. All right, there's a few different things that are common in a lot of different images and a lot of different in photography as well, that's used a lot. So sight lines, I'll explain those. Sight lines, perspective lines, and then just lines and shapes. All right, so sight lines are actually invisible lines. So, but that's based on the idea, if you see someone or a character looking at something, we kind of naturally look at that same place that a person is. So, it's kind of based on the idea, you know, if you're walking down the street and you see a group of people looking up in the air, you are also going to look up and try and see what they are looking at. When you're drawing an image with sight lines, yeah, you're not literally drawing a line, but you can draw characters and things within that composition where the head is turned that way, where the eyes are facing that way, and that will draw the vision that way. Perspective lines are lines. Has anyone ever done a perspective drawing before where you're drawing like a cube, a three-dimensional cube, or you're drawing a railroad that goes off into the distance?
Yeah, or like looking up at the sky in the forest with all the trees going, and you see like, you know, yeah, you typically see it kind of like that. Mm-hmm. Or the reverse of like with buildings.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah.
So there's some really cool ways to compose pictures where you can use perspective lines to frame a focal point and to focus at that. So maybe we want the moon to be the focal point right there. So these drawings are very fun to do, but they're also kind of tricky. But we'll look at some examples here in a sec and we'll draw some examples as well. So that's perspective lines. So you now all these trees we got here are pointing at that moon there. And now these have all become little arrows. And yeah, it's the same thing if you're like looking up in like a downtown city, looking up at a bunch of buildings as well, you'll see the same sort of thing. Or like looking down a long hallway. And then lines and shapes, those are just kind of how you creatively add different things within the composition to act as leading lines as well. So let's do a sight lines example. So know your focal point. So let's just do a little a balloon right there, okay? So we'll put that in there first. Oftentimes I put in the focal point first, not always. But it's a good idea to get the focal point in there early. Even if it's not the first thing, it should be one of the first things. So now I can put all these people down here on the ground. Looking up. At that focal point. And I can even change this person here into a shape that acts as an arrow as well. I can put an arm coming up and pointing up there at that focal point. Then we'll just put them on the ground, put some buildings or something back here. So now hopefully we have these lines in there. We could also add some, you know, some clouds as just other lines and shapes that point there as well. Clouds work really well as leading lines because you can basically make them any shape you want to serve whatever purpose you need. Now we have these invisible sight lines coming up. We got some clouds pointing at them, and we're just bringing the viewer's focus right up to that focal point. So there's some really creative ways that artists use sight lines. It works really well for that representational imagery. And it's kind of a cool trick because there's not literally a line there. It's something invisible, but it still kind of draws our vision there. Any questions on those sight lines there, how to use that?
Could you use like value to make a focal point? Like, you know, light or lighting, I guess, kind of darker edges and a lighter middle or something like that?
Wow, Yes, exactly. You're like skipping ahead on lessons here. Yes, value is also very important for focal points. I will I'll briefly introduce this. We're going to spend a few classes on using value to that. So it's basically using value contrast. So our eye is drawn to the area of highest contrast, meaning really, really dark value against really, really light value. So right now, the balloon is solid black against a bright white sky. And I have a bright white little highlight on there as well. So that's going to draw your vision right there. And I just put a medium value over all of this stuff down here in the bottom, because that stuff's less important and there's less value contrast. So when we did, I did that very quick, like little value scale, which we will do on during another class. So wherever you put really, really dark values here against really, really light values, that will stand out and really draws the viewer attention. So we're going to be learning a number of different ways to make the focal point stand out. So we will eventually, we're going to use leading lines, we'll use value, we'll use shape contrast, we'll use size contrast, we'll use the rule of thirds. All these different tools are just basically ways to make the focal point stand out. And so we kind of just introduce those one at a time, but by the time we get to that final project, you should be using like all of these different things to make your focal point stand out. Good question. So it's good to start thinking about that. Yeah, start thinking about how value works as well. Any other questions on this? Let's look at a perspective lines example. And that was a good question too, because there's not really one way to like teach you guys this in like one order that's the best. I could go to value first and then come back to leading lines, or go to leading lines first and then go to value, then go to shapes. I just kind of have to give it to you, and then eventually we'll combine it all to make really good images and really good artwork. So I'm drawing my focal point here. And a car, I want this car to be driving down a desert road. I'm just gonna put it in the middle. We'll learn next class about kind of where and how to place images in a composition. Sometimes you put it right in the middle, sometimes you put it off to the side. So this car is driving down the road here. So I set that up all right. So those are those perspective lines going off into the distance. They kind of come in and all point there towards the vehicle. I can also put some like hills off in the distance. That basically act as shapes and lines that go towards it. I'm gonna add in some telephone poles here. Which then also brings our vision down there. And so now, can you guys think of anything else I could add to this image that may be a leading line? Or just some general shapes or lines I could add here? That could fit.
Smoke coming off from the back like a old exhaust pipe.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one, yep. Maybe some cracks here in the ground. put some grass texture here that can lead us back.
Maybe some cacti in the distance and in the front.
Yeah. So we'll kind of put one cactus here, kind of how in the abstract version I had those circles get smaller towards the thing. So I'll just have kind of some repeating shapes here of these cactuses as they go towards the thing, the car, focal point. Nice. Okay. So now this is looking pretty good. Look at all those leading lines there. And now I'm just going to, you know, that was Rebecca, right? You asked about the value contrast.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just going to throw in some value here just to introduce the idea. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put kind of a 50% gray over everything. And I want some bright value right here, some bright white on the car, and also some solid black right here. So now I have black against white. So the darkest value and the lightest value are right there on the car. And now look at all this stuff we have making a super clear focal point. Just gonna kind of draw in all those things we're using here. So when you guys look at images now, so these green lines I'm drawing in, this is kind of lines that you're gonna have to start to kind of see yourself when you're looking at an image and when you're creating images as well. I'm not gonna literally draw these lines on every drawing that I create, but I wanna start to think about it that way. And when I look at other artists' work, that's how I start to think about their work and look at their work as well. So there's a number of different ways to do it. So it kind of becomes you to have these creative solutions for how to come up with this different stuff and how to create an interesting composition that uses leading lines. Any questions on any of this? Okay, let's look at some artwork that uses leading lines really well. Leading lines. Okay, this is a good one right here. So this is the artist N.C. Wyeth. He is an illustrator, worked, classic American illustrator, worked in the 40s and 50s. This image is from the book Treasure Planet. So looking at master's work and people that are more experienced than us, I said, is a really good way to get better at artists or get better at art ourselves. But we don't want to just kind of glance at it and move on to the next one. We want to analyze it and kind of study it. So oftentimes the first thing I ask myself when I look at an image like this is, what is the focal point? What is the main thing the artist wants us to look at? So when you guys look at this image, what do you think is the focal point here?
The person on the top.
The person on the top, exactly.
Holding two guns, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this guy here on top, holding two guns. So I would call that the primary focal point. That's the main focal point. Does he have a secondary focal point?
Bottom one?
Yep, the other guy. So lots of times it's easy. When there's people in a composition, lots of times people are the focal point. That's the subject matter of a lot of stories, of a lot of imagery. So you can oftentimes just guess that the people are the focal point. So now what sort of leading lines are here that stand out to you guys?
The ropes on the ship.
Exactly, the ropes on the ship. So he composed this picture on a boat, on a ship, and a ship is covered in ropes all over the place. So he knew that there's going to be a lot of opportunities to create leading lines here. So boom, already there's a bunch of stuff, and he could kind of just put those wherever, and he composed them in a way where they're pointing at that focal point. He doesn't really have to follow a lot of rules. You know, it's a boat, there's ropes all over the place. He can just kind of make them go in the direction that he wants. Any other leading lines here or shapes used as leading lines?
The boat's mast.
Yeah, that's a big one. So that really moves our eye. And make that one nice and thick and bold through the entire composition from top down and from the bottom up. Any other ones you guys see?
Their limbs.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah.
The and, way, and the shadows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just the way he composes the poses of the character. So this kind of creates a back and forth between these two focal points. One character is pointing down with the guns, the other guy's whole body and pose creates kind of an arrow shape pointing up. And our vision is kind of bounces back and forth between those two. Now there's a really subtle one in the background. Do you guys see it?
The birds.
Yeah, this is my favorite part.
I always like adding birds to compositions, but I'm like, am I making this too cliche?
No, I always add birds. Birds are great, especially off in the distance. It adds a sense of motion and movement oftentimes. And when you walk around in everyday life, lots of times there's birds in the background. So don't ever worry about adding birds in there. So this one is done really well. You know, it takes a while to plan out these more complicated ones. To make these things really read well and read clearly. So he probably had to go through a few different rough sketch versions before he settled on this final composition. But after he did that, it ended up working really well as a composition. Let's look at a scene from film. So have you guys seen Breaking Bad before? I think it's on Netflix still. So cool show. It has really good cinematography in the show. And I really like the way they compose the shots because the shots tell a lot, a good amount of story with it. So looking at this, what is the focal point here?
The guy sitting in the chair looking at the guy on the right.
So which guy is the focal point? One or two?
Standing
two.
Two, exactly, yeah. So this gets into that dark shape. Look how dark this character is. He's almost in shadow and he's against this bright white sky there. So this becomes just a really dark shape standing out, surrounded by all this light space right there. So there is our focal point. Focal point right there. Yes, Jesse there. So now what sort of leading lines do you guys see here? I think one was mentioned just a second ago.
Yeah, the guy in the chair looking at the exactly. Jesse.
So here's a really good example of sight lines, vision lines there. So there's not literally a line there, but it brings our vision there because his head's turned that way and we kind of follow what he's looking at. What else do you guys see in here?
The RV and the grass, it's like patchy as it leads up to where he's standing.
Exactly, the trailer, the RV.
The cloud.
Was that the clouds, did I hear?
Is it a cloud, the cloud on the sky? Can it be? It's kind of pointing at him.
Oh, yeah, definitely. So that's, I mean, I find it much or very impressive to do with actors and sets because this is all about you have to tell the actors the right place to stand. You have to wait for the right time of day to get that dark shape. You have to put the camera at the right angle so things are lined up in a correct way. So this isn't done just by accident. This is good directors and good cinematographers are looking for this sort of stuff when they're trying to compose a scene and figure out where they want characters to stand, where they want the props to be, and things like that, when they find certain locations for things to work out. So when you guys are watching movies and TV shows, now you guys can start to look for this as well. So look for stuff, see what directors are trying to think, how are they trying to make certain things stand out, and how are they trying to compose these pictures to use leading lines and make a clear focal point. So yeah,
it's subtle, but I mean, they also managed to keep the other characters' clothing closer to the color of the ground. So I mean, sightline, but you kind of, it's a color scheme where you manage to skip over the other person in the frame.
Yeah, there's less value contrast there. Exactly. Yeah. So we can just like, turn down the saturation there. So you see, this is that really dark value that stands out, where this value is much closer. Even his dark hair is against the darker truck there rather than being, or the darker trailer there rather than being against the bright white sky. So sometimes I'll do this too. I'll turn an image to black and white, and then you can kind of see just the values there, and that allows you to see it without being distracted by bright, cool, exciting colors and things like that. But very good, very well defined composition there. And here is an example with perspective lines. So this is from The Shining, if anyone's ever seen that horror movie, Jack Nicholson. Classic old horror movie. Focal point. So I said focal point is usually people. And if it's people, it's going to be usually their faces. Like, we're not going to be looking at his leg down there. That's not what they want us to look at. They want us to look at how these two faces of those characters are interacting. And then boom, all these leading lines. So this is finding that the location, and then telling those actors where to stand to have all those leading lines in there. So start to think about, you guys can not directly, you know, copy things like this, but for one of the projects, the point, for the second project, the point is going to be, it's called focal point and leading line. So you want to create an image that has a clear focal point. So you can have a character standing in a room or in a hallway and have all of those leading lines going towards there, or have, it doesn't even need to be a person. It can be a shape or an object or any, whatever your focal point is, can be in that hallway. And think about being inspired by these images that we see here that you may find on your own, and then taking that and making it into your own. So I definitely want you guys to be inspired by these images. I don't want you to copy them directly, but you can use them and change them and make them into your own and help you to get ideas for how to use leading lines. So a lot of these images here, the Breaking Bad one, when I'm watching movies or whatever, I'll just pause the movie and take a screenshot when I see something I really like or something that's really interesting to me, and be like, okay, I might, you know, borrow this composition for a comic book later, or a storyboard later, or an illustration later. So start to just kind of keep your eyes peeled for stuff like that as you come across it in your daily life when you're watching TV and watching movies and stuff like that. All right. Any questions on any more of this stuff? On any of focal point, leading lines, value contrast? Okay. So we will come back to this more next week and in the following weeks, but just know focal point is going to be a main thing we are talking about for the entire quarter. So always ask yourself when you're doing the drawing, is there a clear focal point? All right. Let me just, so now we'll, I'm just going to kind of introduce Illustrator a little bit and give a quick demo of a few things that you should practice. And then I will send you on your way to kind of take what I showed you and then practice it on your own. All right, let me just show you guys an example of the first project. Okay, so this is from last quarter, so project one. Let's do January 18th. So it's gonna come quick, even though it's in 2 weeks. So here's all the general directions. So basically you're just gonna be making 6 boxes in Illustrator. There is a template like this. And you just have to make boxes that are a specific size and specific spacing from the sides. So this is just to kind of make sure you can follow directions and make sure that you can manipulate Illustrator in a way that allows you to do that. So you can know how to add the rulers to the thing and make boxes a specific size and line them all up so they're aligned correctly and things like that. So it'll basically kind of look like this when you're done. Each box has different requirements for things that are in it. So one box has lines, one has rectangles, one has ovals, one has polygons, one is drawn with the pen tool, and one is a free choice down there, okay? So this probably looks pretty complicated to you guys since you're just very now getting used to the program. So I'm just going to demo, actually, I'm going to first show you the videos. Where did they go? Just 1 second, let me pull these up here. Thought I hadn't pulled up. I think I, did I send you guys that link last class?
The link to those videos? Or...
Yeah. Here it is again.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did.
Cool. Here it is again in case anyone needs that. All right. So this is all of the Illustrator tutorials. This will basically take us through the entire class. Once we get back in the classroom, I'll be going over with these with you in person. But they're just a good resource to have if you ever need a refresher or review or help with anything and it's not during class. So over the weekend and until next week, you should kind of get through episodes 1 through 4. Okay, that should kind of be the basic things that you should be able to do here. So I'm just going to kind of demo very quickly what's in those videos and kind of show you how to use that program and get through here. So when you open Illustrator, it will look something like this. Okay, maybe a little bit different, but to create a new document, you just go create new. So for our class, we are always going to be working in 8.5 by 11. That's a good standard size. It's a standard paper size as well. And we're just going to use that for all the projects. Okay. So when you do that, you can choose any one of these. But you can also put in right here, 8.5 by 11. And always check this and make sure this is inches. Some people will have this set as points, and that means that's the pixels basically. So it's gonna be super, super small. It'll be different as well if you use millimeters or centimeters. So just make sure that's on inches, 8.5 by 11. You can change the orientation if you want to be horizontal, but we're going to, yeah, we will always be using the vertical landscape. And artboards, for the most part to start out, just use one artboard. Eventually, we will use more than one artboard, but that's when we're kind of getting ready to save your project and make it presentable with multiple pages in there. So to just set up 8.5 by 11 with one artboard. And your screen will look about like this. It may look a little different. What version do I have? This is 2018, so mine's a little bit older. You guys probably have the 2020 version, so it might look slightly different. But the biggest thing is right here. This kind of shows the layout of how the program is presented. I find the Essentials Classic is the best one. And that's the one I use in all the demo videos. When we get in class, I will always be on Essentials Classic. And that's just kind of a good layout for this when you start using the program. So with Illustrator, there is always multiple ways to do the same thing. So if you find a different way to do something that makes more sense to you, that is completely fine. Sometimes your tools will be in slightly different places, but I'll kind of just show you guys the basic way that I've done stuff and the way that makes the most sense to me. But again, like I said, you may find a slightly different way to do that. So this tool right here, this selection tool is very important, okay? So this is a very important tool that's gonna be used a lot. And this is a tool that's used to move shapes around and resize shapes. So when you're working in this program, it's a shape-based program. You're basically just creating flat shapes of different types of shapes, but flat shapes to then compose a larger image or a larger picture. So this is gonna be a tool. And if you notice, as you mouse over these tools, it shows you the name of it. And it also has that little letter by it. So selection tool is V. So I would say get used to those keyboard shortcuts just because it makes it quicker and easier to use the program if you know those keyboard shortcuts. So I'll usually have one hand on my keyboard and then just one hand on the mouse and I'll go back and forth that way. So this is going to be the first shapes I'm going to have you guys create are just these basic shapes. So anytime you see a tiny little triangle right by this rectangle, that means if you hold on that tool, then there's other options underneath it. Okay, so this rectangle tool is just drawing basic rectangles. The rounded rectangle tool is drawing a rounded rectangle. Ellipse tool is drawing ovals, and the polygon tool is drawing different sided shapes. So let's just start with that rectangle tool. So with that rectangle tool, you can just click and drag and draw rectangles. So what's always kind of weird to me and to when people that first start using this program is, let's say I want to go back and change this rectangle here. Once I have it created, in order to change it, I have to switch back to my selection tool. So that's one of the things that takes a little while to figure that out, and it seems not quite intuitive. So once you draw anything, whether it's a shape with a rectangle tool or ellipse tool or a custom shape you draw later on, in order to manipulate this later on, you have to switch back to this tool and then you can move it around, okay? And you can resize it and change it around like that. So whenever this thing is selected, since this is a select tool, it becomes blue around it. And it has all these little, these are called anchor points, these little dots. This then allows you to manipulate that rectangle. So I can go from rectangle to rectangle and change it around. Okay, and once one's selected, you can delete it just by hitting the delete or backspace button to get rid of it. And you can do the same thing. I'm gonna switch to the ellipse tool and draw some ovals as well, same idea. And you'll notice if you click just once, single click, it brings up this option box and you can make rectangles a specific size. So like 2 inches by 2 inches. Now, if I want to move that rectangle again, I have to come back to the selection tool. Okay, so this is going to feel kind of fast. So that's why I'm going to send you guys off to practice with those videos after we're done. So if we were in the classroom, I would have you guys doing this along with me. And I would kind of walk around the room to make sure everything's going okay. So we're kind of doing a little workaround since we're online. But I just want you to know, as you see, when this is created, it defaults to having a stroke and fill. So the fill is whatever color is inside, and the stroke is the line that goes around the outside. So every shape you create is going to have a given stroke and fill. So you can always change that stroke and fill, okay? And there's a couple places to change it. You can change it down here. This one is your fill. See, I mouse over it and it says fill. And this one is the stroke. You can also change it up here. Is the fill, and here is the stroke. Okay, so let's just change this fill to red. Okay, and you can also change the thickness of the stroke right here. So now that we can see this stroke really well, I can change that color to like blue. So that's kind of the basics of what I want you guys to get down this first week and over the weekend is make sure you can open up a document, make it the correct size, move these, create basic rectangles and ellipses, move them around and resize them, and then change the stroke and the fill. Okay, I can also change it down here. Oh, this is weird. I have to change this setting somehow. Okay, so making that stroke thin or thick. You can also turn this off if you choose this one with a little red slash through it. And now it kind of disappears there because it has a white fill, but I want to put a different color in there. Okay, that probably seems like a lot to you guys just to start off, but those are kind of the basic things that when we're done here today and over the weekend, just go in, practice opening up this document, making those basic shapes, moving and rearranging them and resizing them with the selection tool, and then see if you can change the stroke and the fill on these different shapes, okay? Does that kind of make sense for what I would like you guys to practice and try and figure out?
Makes sense to me.
All right. Any questions on this? Anything like really weird and screaming at you that I just went over?
Don't think so.
Okay. So those videos is basically the same things I just went through. So how to open Illustrator, how to draw the basic shapes, how to change the stroke and fill, and how to use the ellipse and polygon tools. So if you guys can master 1 through 4 over the weekend, you're gonna be in a really good place for getting ready for project one. If like you get through those, some people, this comes a lot more naturally to some people, it's gonna take a lot longer. So you kind of just have to reflect on yourself. Are you a technology person that picks this up really quick, or does things like this take you guys a little bit longer? Whatever it is, if you know, if you're going through it quick, feel free to work ahead onto these next videos. Because next week I'm gonna have you guys try episodes 5 through 9, okay? So you'll be on a good pace if you can get through episode 1 through 4. I would say kind of follow along with those videos. Try and do the same things and then close down the videos, put it away, and then try and do it without the videos as well. Because like I said, it just takes a lot of repetition. And the more you spend time in the program, the more used to it you will get. And there's like a whole bunch of tools over here. We'll probably end up using probably a quarter to half of these tools. There's a lot we will not use at all. But just know that these are all different tools and we'll get to a lot of these throughout the quarter, but definitely not all of them because there's a lot in this program and a lot that Illustrator can do. All right, so I'm gonna leave you guys with that. And then my expectation is you guys for to just go in and practice with Illustrator over the next few days and over the weekend. I also have that drawing challenge. So I'll send this message around with the link to those videos and a reminder about the drawing challenge. But that is going to be it for today. If you guys have questions, let me know before you log off or send me a message in Canvas during the week, and I will do my best to get back to you guys. But that is it for today.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Have a good week. See you next week.
Sounds good. Bye. Yep. I'll see you guys on Monday.
Bye.